good morning to everyone, and welcome to the National Sports Council. I'm Sylvester Ford, a member of the board of the National Sports Council, and on behalf of the council, and indeed on behalf of the World Road Tennis Federation, pleased to see all of you here, and particularly this morning, I'm extremely pleased to welcome on board, let me say, the City of Bridgetown Cooperative Credit Union, of which I happen to be a member. So represented here by Chief Executive Officer, Mr. Glendon Steve Bell, and Mr. Winston Alleyne from their marketing department. To my left, I have MacArthur Barrow of the World Road Tennis Federation, and Philip Garner, also of the World Road Tennis Federation. The purpose for this meeting this morning is to announce the major sponsorship for the World Road Tennis Championships, the first World Road Tennis Championships to be held here in Barbados, come November 9th at the Springer Memorial School and culminating on the 13th. That, of course, you will recognize means Wednesday of next week through to Sunday when we will have the big finals. Now, my role here this morning is to do what I just did, which was to introduce the members of the head table. And at this point, I'm going to ask MacArthur Barrow, who has been the key driving force, if I may say so, behind this collaborative effort between the National Sports Council and the World Road Tennis Federation in getting these championships to the point where they are about to actually take place. And I'm sure he's going to have a few words of welcome to say to the representatives from the City of Bridgetown Cooperative Credit Union. And he will also walk you through the details of what will take place over the next few days. So, Matt, let's exchange places.
Okay, good morning, everyone. Thanks, Sylvester, for the introduction. I'm MacArthur Barrow of the World Road Tennis Federation. So this morning, you know, we're all here very excited because we want to welcome on board the City of Bridgetown Cooperative Credit Union. And thanks very much for having the presence here, Mr. Steve Bell, and who's the CEO, and Winston. Good to see you, sir. All right. Of course, we welcome local sponsorship for these sort of major events. Road tennis, as you all know, has suddenly catapulted itself to the national forefront. This has not been an overnight process, and I do want to thank many of the stalwarts who have done yeoman service over the years in laying the foundation for what is now bearing fruit for not only the players, but also for every single Barbadian. I want to take a moment to talk about the development of road tennis and how we see it as it develops into the future. And it's very interesting because as we go all over the world telling people about road tennis as far as field as China, throughout the Caribbean and so on, we tell them the same story. And the story is this. We in the Caribbean are wonderful at sports in general. Our cricket team has certainly in the past dominated the world. Our footballers and our volleyball players and our basketball players are of international renown. And this is because we in the Caribbean are blessed with our own natural abilities and sporting abilities and so on. What we've done in these cases is taken another sport that's developed outside of the Caribbean and certainly outside of Barbados, and we've become extremely well good at it. What we're trying to do with road tennis is actually the complete reverse. What we're trying to do with road tennis is take a sport that was developed right here in Barbados and package it in an internationally palatable format. And it's a challenging process. It's a process that many of us have given our lives to. And on my left, I see Philip Garner, who is one of the stalwarts of this game, not only as a player, but also as an organizer from as far back as when I was a kid in diapers, right, Philip? And of course, the process and the work of making road tennis an international sport has a long way to go still. But as we do things like put on a world championship, This signals to the world that we are, in fact, ready to serve this game up as an international sport fit to be played right throughout the world. How we've gone about that process is that we've worked with individual countries throughout the world, and you'll see many of them, not necessarily all of them, but you'll see many of them at the championships in a few days. I mean, take, for example, the USA or Jamaica. Jamaica uses a wonderful example, because many of us see Jamaica as kind of a shining beacon in development of sports, not only here in the Caribbean, but throughout the world. Jamaican sportspersons are lauded everywhere in the world. And they have really taken to world tennis in a big way, and in fact are sending, I think, the second biggest contingent to the championships. But with that country, what it entails is that we invited them here for a workshop, which we held in Barbados in December last year. And then we did a tour to that country, I think it was in May. And during that tour, one of the key developmental points was we had to ensure that they formed the Road Tennis Association of Jamaica. Actually, it's called Road Tennis Jamaica. Now, with that structure in place, it means that they can now develop players on the ground fairly rapidly. And because road tennis developed in Barbados the way it did historically, it evolved from the 1930s. But it's not until the 1970s and the formation of the Barbados Road Tennis Association that you actually saw accelerated development of the sport. Now, and then in the year 2000, we saw the formation of the World Road Tennis Federation. What we are trying to do is compress that learning experience into a very short period of time. So therefore, when we go to a country like Jamaica, we assist them in the formation of their Road Tennis Association, and it becomes an affiliate member of the World Road Tennis Federation, much as the Barbados Football Association would be an affiliate member of FIFA. Now, with the formation of their local association, we will hopefully see that accelerated development that we saw in Barbados, because the real development of road tennis in Barbados started in earnest in the 80s after the formation of the BRTA and its affiliation to the National Sports Council in 1984. Okay, so that, with that as a background, obviously one of our big challenges, having put on a number of tournaments, very, very big and successful tournaments in Barbados in recent times, by a number of different organizations. The key is, how do we put all this together and get persons from across the region and further afield to compete against each other in an international tournament? And this was the dream of our Minister of Sport, the Honorable Minister Lashley. And he's asked the World Road Tennis Federation to work in conjunction with the National Sports Council to put that dream into reality for the 50th anniversary of Barbados. So I'm really excited that we've got to this point at this time. I'm particularly excited that my good friend, Stephen Bell, old work colleague of mine, has partnered with us in putting this on, because we feel that it is work of national significance. And we feel that Barbadians as a whole really need to see road tennis as a product of them, as their product. It's our product that we have collectively worked together at for a number of years, and are now offering this product to the world. And it's very exciting for us to do so. So, enough of that sort of salesman pitch. Now, onto the main course. I do want to welcome COB on board as our major sponsor. I will tell you a bit about the structure of the tournament. The tournament is made up of 7 categories, and the categories are the open men and the open ladies. And I'll explain why the use of the word open in a minute. And then we have the masters and the juniors, and we have exciting doubles. It's not a normal category for road tennis local competitions, but we feel it's a really critical format category, and therefore we've included it. We've included a category called international men and international ladies, and we also are going to be offering a demonstration, and I'll explain a little bit more about that after we get some comments from COB. we included a demonstration of road tennis for those with special needs. And we're really excited about that aspect of this program as well. Now, the open men's category and the open ladies category is going to see competition at Springer School in the last 16 players, and the top 16 players, actually the top 14 players, because two of the two best international players in each category will compete in the open men and the open ladies, which is why it's called open men and open ladies. As we, one of the key objectives of this entire program, and certainly for the formation of the World Road Tennis Federation, is the development of road tennis outside of Barbados, obviously. And as I told you, we had this program where we are going to these various territories and working with them in their formation of associations and the creation of road tennis players. Because this process, certainly for some places like Jamaica, Guyana, and so on, really started this year, the level of development of those players is nowhere near the development, obviously, of local players. And I know in talking to certain pundits and so on, everybody wants to see our number one player versus the number one player from St. Vincent and so on. The reality of it is that road tennis is a fledgling sport in those territories. And therefore, it is not... If a player from St. Vincent were to be even on number 15 player, then I would be quite surprised. And so what we are doing is using this opportunity to allow them to compete against players of similar standing, hence the international categories of men and women, and then the top two players from each category have an opportunity to play against the very best in the world, which is the players from Barbados. So I hope that helps persons who were a little unclear in why the tournament is structured the way it's structured. It really is to be consistent with our mandate of helping the development of sport in those territories. And hopefully by them competing against players of similar standing, they will get excited, they will want to come back again and compete in the next tournament. Okay. As I said, the tournament is in seven categories. We have participants from how many countries? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, including Barbados. It's headed by the USA, and they're sending the highest number of players. I think they're sending 5 players. Most other territories, except Jamaica and St. Vincent, I think, are sending 3. Jamaica, Canada, St. Lucia, St. Vincent, Guyana, Barbados, they're all competing in this tournament. Those players, we have worked very hard with a number of those players. We've created internationally qualified coaches in many of those territories so that they themselves can create coaches and coach players. And I was really pleasantly surprised to get an email from Guyana, who are also, by the way, celebrating their 50th year of anniversary of independence. And they sent me a photo of a really big road tennis coaching clinic in the center of Georgetown in a facility that was built specifically for their 50th year anniversaries. And it was a fantastic photo of these young players being coached by a coach that we created. A Guyanese coach that we created, coaching these school children, and there were hundreds of them. And it really was very pleasing to see that this is exactly the kind of development that we want to see with the sport. Okay. Obviously, the finals will be at Springer School, as we all talked about. It's starting on the, it's there from the 9th until the 13th. We are going to be starting, and Philip will talk a bit about this a bit later in terms of the schedule, but we'll be starting with the international teams and so on, and culminating in the finals. All the finals will be played on the final day of Sunday. All right, well, I suppose I missed the really big thing, and that they'll be playing for $20,000 in prize in cash money to the winner. And we've been particularly forceful that the winning lady wins the same exact money as the winning men. And when I was talking to various ladies around, and when we were planning this, The one thing they told me was, Matt, make sure that the winning lady wins exactly the same amount of money as the winning man. Otherwise, you can't come home. So therefore, that is what it is. So we're very excited to say that. And that leads me then directly on to our sponsors who have worked with us to ensure that we can offer all these nice things. Steve, over to you.
Yeah, thanks, Mark. Okay, thanks, Mark. Members of the Board of the National Sports Council, officials of the World Tennis Championships Committee, specially invited guests, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the Executive Board, Management, and staff of the City of Bridgetown Cooperative Credit Union, I'm pleased to express our appreciation to the Committee of the Championships for inviting us to be the title sponsor of this renowned sporting event. For our Barbadians, Royal Tennis rules the streets, and it's proudly noted that the game is played by people from all social classes, groups, sex, race, and religions. Many have recognized the appeal the sports has engendered, both locally and internationally, and the champions, both male and females, who have soared to the top of their game, thus making it a sport of great distinction. As title sponsor of this international championship, we at COB deem it necessary fit in embracing the indigenous appeal of this game, as well as the celebration of our island's 50th anniversary of independence. The COB, Cooperative Credit Union, can be easily described as an indigenous institution, and we pride ourselves in ensuring that our members, ranging from all social classes, benefit from the wide range of products and services designed and offered with them in mind. Following the culmination of this championship, we eagerly look forward to continued dialogue with all concerned parties in ensuring that a viable relationship can be sustained as we blend the strength of the COB brand with that of Road Tennis, and ensuring that we promote the partnership to a local and international audience. We congratulate all parties involved in the staging of this World Tennis Championship, and we look forward to some exciting moments throughout the staging of the games. We thank you.
There are a number of other things. I do want to also identify that there are a number of other subsidiary sponsors as well. We want to thank Turbo Energy Drink, who run its Cran Water, and I see they have supplied us with some water today. Fruit of Juices, we want to also thank Sports.bb for their assistance in terms of sponsorship. We really appreciate everybody being hands-on with the development of Road Tennis. Okay. There are a number of categories. As I said, there are seven categories, and the entrants to this tournament were extremely high. Our challenge is we want to put on this tournament in a very concise format, so we want it to start on, but we know it's planned to start between the 9th and the 13th. So in 5 days, we have to get through a number of matches. So in order to make this thing possible, we've asked the tournament manager, who is our technical director, right, Philip? to put on a preliminary set of matches where he can basically bring the numbers down to no more than 16 per category. Yeah, I got it covered. So that they can play in a reasonable time frame at Springer. So, Philip, I am going to ask you to give us an update on the progress of the preliminaries as we move towards the big day of the 9th.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, let us say thanks to the City of Bridgetown Credit Union for again involving this Road Tennis and the other sponsors. I must say, because of the structure of this competition, I think it is the reason that we attracted so much players in this World Road Tennis Championship. In the open category, we attracted 58 persons. And that's actually a record number. In the Masters category, 47. In the Ladies category, we attracted 28 persons, which I think is also a record number. The Juniors category, 21. Actually, I had to turn back players because of the time span that we were looking at. And the doubles right now, we have 24, we had a shot at off 24 persons entering the doubles. 24, actually 48 persons, yeah. And right now, I actually finishing tonight, we'll be finishing off in the preliminaries, the open men and the open ladies, and the open masters. The ladies already started. I have still have roughly about 10 sets to play off in the open ladies, and about 13 sets to play off in the juniors. We want expect to start the doubles on Sunday night, and I think the doubles that going to be finished on. We actually finishing everything on Sunday. So what we're doing at this point in time, we're going to be taking 14 persons from the open men category, and bringing the 2 persons from the international category to make it 16. And all other categories, we'll be eliminating them, those categories to 8, which is the quarterfinals. And on the 5 days that we have to play from the 9th to the 13th, I think we are actually have adequate time to finish all of those categories. So the whole long short story, everything is well on stream, and we're expecting a very good competition. Actually, all the guys are very eager to get involved in this competition. It's not only $20,000 that are at stake, there are second, third, and fourth places. And that's one of the reasons, too, that so much persons are being attracted to this competition in all categories. And that's a good thing, because we really have to appreciate, on the behalf of the Royal Tennis Players and the Royal Tennis Association and the world body, we have to give thanks to the City of Bridgestone Credit Union for getting involved so seriously in this competition, so we could attract that kind of finance for all these players. So actually, that is my part of it. If there's any questions, I don't know any person will ask any question in terms of the structure of the competition, in terms of the kind of players, all the top players are being involved in this competition. Ladies categories, men's category, and in terms of the doubles, you find that some of the guys, majority of the guys that play in the open category will also be playing in the doubles as usual. So that's the main structure of the whole competition up to this point.
If you could clarify something for me, you said that 14 players, local players, will be advancing to the finals.
Yeah, we've eliminated
and
the 14.
We met with the 2 qualifying international players. Mm. So how much time span do you have in there to qualify those 2 players to then play with the 14?
As soon as they arrive in Barbados on the 9th, we'll be doing their preliminaries. And bring that down to 2, and then we bring them over to the 14.
So will the fixtures be already done up for the 2 gaps remaining there, or they will not be done until they are?
Yes, the fixtures will be finished by the time they get here, and then we do the preliminaries, and then we bring over the 2 from the international category, and also the international ladies and
For example, in the men's open, which is the one we were talking about, we've already charted all of the matches, and therefore the chart is existing with 2 gaps, as you quite rightly said, two open boxes for the 2 top players from the international category to sit there. So, for example, I've got one chart in front of me, but Phil will be able to tell you who exactly is playing the winning international match. Here. So that's already been charted in the fixtures, really. So I think we are more or less pretty certain on how that is going to be. No question mark is
who's going to be
the top international man and who's going to be number 2 international. That's something for the ladies.
At the World Tennis Federation, what title will you be according the non-Barbadians? And what time will you be according to the Barbadians who emerged up in this tournament?
Well, obviously, whoever wins the open category is the world champion. That's the open category. That's why it's called open. And the person who wins the international category will be obviously the international champions.
I'm trying to determine whether you as the World Room Tennis Federation will indicate which is the higher rank title.
No, but you won't put, obviously the world champion.
What I'm scared about is that somebody decided to invite World Tennis to take part in a CAC tournament or an American tournament. Sent for the international champion as opposed to the world champion. That's what I'm trying to determine. Will you categorize them to indicate which is the higher title, because that will be within your ambit.
Let me see if I can assist you. This is an initial exercise. As was pointed out earlier, the overseas players will not be of the standard.
I know that.
Of the Barbadian players. All right. So hence, those who win the open category in this exercise at this point will be the world champions. Down the road, yes, when the people in the other countries are able to approach the World World Tennis Federation, more than likely will look at the situation as it exists at that point, and what is now the open category will not necessarily apply. Does that help you?
I am aware of everything you're saying, Sylvester. All I am saying is that you are privileged to that information, I am privileged to that information. The guy out there who is not aware that the guys coming from Guyana who would have won an international title are not very strong players. But hearing that they are the international champion, they will most likely gravitate towards them.
Yeah.
So now all I'm asking is whether the World Tennis Federation will rank the people so that anybody would be aware that, hey,
correct,
if Venom or Jackson wins the Barbados, they are better, they are going to be higher than the person from Guyana or Trinidad. That's all I'm asking.
Correct.
And I'm answering this way. I think it's a good question over there for the understanding. And I'm assuming that the question really pertains to ranking.
Yeah.
Right. And yes, we will be ranking, and we will be releasing an international ranking. Right now, to effect this tournament, we actually had to do a ranking, but we can only do an effective ranking for local players because the international players are not effectively ranked. So this tournament is actually going to be the first occasion that we have to rank them. And they will obviously fall into the ranking that is indicated in the open tournament. So, for example, if and I want to say Curtis Jones because I don't want to say Mark Bellow, who just won the last one, or Julian White, who probably won the one before that. So, suppose a player like Mark Bellow were to win this tournament, he would obviously, in the open category, he would obviously be ranked by our ranking number one player. And if an international player, one of the two, were to come number four in this, he would rank number four in the world. And so I hope that clears up. At first, I didn't understand the question.
I don't know, that clarifies it. It's ironic you should mention Curtis Jones and your rankings, because how did you achieve your rankings for this tournament?
Well, we're using a method that looks at all of the tournaments played over the last 12 months, and we're using a rolling method so that in the next...
You mean all of the tournaments played in Barbados?
All of the major tournaments. We wouldn't necessarily include a tournament that was held in Barbados, all of the national tournaments.
Yeah.
And irrespective of the organizer of the tournament. So for example, we know the National Sports Council organizes a number of tournaments, and we know that one of the local organizers, PRTA, organizes tournaments. And we know outside of that ambit, there are some other national tournaments that are organized. And because we are privy to the winning places in all those tournaments, we use that over a rolling 12 months as the gauge to who, and of course we would assign a simple numerical point system. And out would fall who the number one player based on the number of tournaments you play and the points you accumulate. And because it's a rolling 12 months, it keeps up to date. So if you haven't played in a while, then obviously you will go off the scale. And as the more recent tournaments, only the tournaments in the last 12 months will have been.
So how did Curtis John get to be number three?
Well, there's as I said, there's a ranking system based on points. And I believe he, because of that point system, he fell to being three.
Okay, in the open men's category, the first price would be $20,000, Barbados dollars. The second price would be $7,500. And the two losing semifinalists will be $2,500. In the ladies category, the winner, $20,000. Second price, $6,000. And the two losing semifinalists, $2,000. In the masters category, the winner, $7,000. Second price, $4,000. And the two losing semifinalists, $2,000. That's the four major, that's the three major categories and the prize monies. There are also prizes in the doubles, the juniors, international ladies and men.
Anybody else has any questions before I continue? You know, one of the it's a good point. One of the things that we do when we're trying to get these tournaments run is how do we get enough money to do everything? So I agree with you. We couldn't get everybody exactly the way we want because ultimately in the end we're constrained by how much money we have to play with.
There's just one question. We expect a number of people in that area. Parking is going to be a challenge. So, what are the logistics to ensure that people are not dissuaded from coming to the finals, given the limited space?
Well, we're going to have parking stewards that are going to assist in terms of helping persons to park. I agree that there's going to be a parking challenge, but there is a parking lot just next to a church there. We're going to be working with them to get permission to park there. So there's facilities. There's just not enough within the confines of Springer School itself, but in the environs, I think there's enough. So we are working to get that happen.
I have a question. Quite often we focus on players.
It's a really good question, actually. And it's one that we've pondered on at the World Road Tennis Federation at a meeting only as recently as 2 days ago. I am certainly meeting with all the officials. When is it? It's tomorrow.
Tomorrow,
where I'm going to be giving them a brief on the expectation for a tournament of this caliber. We have, in the past, put on score training programs. And we are hoping to put them on again so that we can develop a growing cadre of trained officials. But it is a category of it is a category that we know we must focus on. But as I said, we've put on scores clinics before, and but the game has changed. Not the basic format of the game. Basic format again is stayed the same, but the real challenge in being an official of a sport is handling the pressure under that high intensity focus. And there's no doubt that the high intensity focus has gone up 2 or 3 pegs over the years. And therefore, we do have to relook at their training. But I am working with the officials to make sure that they themselves are aware of the kind of isn't really seeing the ball on or off, you know. Is the fortitude to say that ball is on and off when there are 100 supporters telling you that the ball is on. So I think it's an excellent question. We are working at it. We've been particularly mindful in the selection of the scores that we're using. Philip, the tournament manager, has handpicked those scores. And as I said, I'm working with them myself to ensure that they're up to the standard.
World Championships also requires volunteers. Do you have a
core volunteer? Well, we'd be happy if you would join.
It's all volunteers.
I already have 20 volunteers.
Yeah, we have people who are working with us in terms of helping out, whether it is at the venue, during match days, and so on. And Philip has a number of, not just voluntary, but he has a number of support personnel who are working with us.
What?
National team. Just one more question. National teams, you don't have a core venue, say,
No, we don't have Athletes Village at the moment. We have worked with three local hotels who really worked well with us in terms of giving us preferential rates and so on, in housing these, in terms of moving them around. The National Sports Council has thankfully offered the services of their courts so that we will be able to move them not only from the airport, but also to and from the games. And I believe they're giving us a little freebie island tour. We have our hotel partners who are working with us in providing accommodation for it.
Yeah, this tennis seem to be like this is, I've covered a lot of them, and there are a lot of pitches that most of you all like nuts. Here we are, or are we all, but somehow they're not that important. Fortunately, you have spring, or you have something hanging over in case of the rain. But all the tennis I've covered, if that rain comes up, who knows, will be held back for a period of time. You are depending, I'm hoping that they will be there. And tennis is good. The other entity that exists with this tennis, they have the government aspect and there is a private aspect. Is there? Are you all working together? I said that tennis really like this is, but are you taking it serious enough that you will try to create somewhere? The government has a lot of land all the place that run in here. Is it worthwhile considering the way tennis is going to consider to make these guys very comfortable? The audience, they're very compromising. I go to all tennis and you never see a big crowd. All the basketball, all the stuff, no people. Are you taking this thing seriously enough? So listen, let us get this thing.
The mere fact that we are actually staging this world tournament suggests, or ought to suggest, that road tennis is being taken very, very seriously. And since you would have heard that the Minister of Sports himself has been very, very keen on seeing this tournament come to fruition, suggest that it is being taken seriously. In terms of providing a facility for dedicated to road tennis, and this is a very personal view, that in my mind is not necessarily the route to go. We've had the inter-parish road tennis finals at Dover some years ago, and we used a big tent for that purpose. For this tournament, we looked at a couple of other options where we might have been able to use a covered facility, and since Springer is the most central location which offers some coverage, we decided that we would go to Springer. Now, naturally, when the gymnasium is back in operation, that will also be a venue for road tennis and might very well prove to be the central venue for road tennis. We, within the last year or so, have actually put down a road tennis court in the gymnasium. It has been tried and tested. It is a concrete-based court. It is something which can be replicated in a number of areas so that you don't necessarily have to use the car park or the road as the case may be. But once the game begins to evolve, yes, you are going to see more and more facilities. We've got the Power Road facility at Bashal, yeah. I can tell you that there is a space at Haynesville which has a couple of good road tennis courts, and they have asked for a couple more courts to be marked out in that area, and that is going to be done by the National Sports Council. So between the World Road Tennis Federation, the National Sports Council, and indeed all of the bodies which are engaged in the promotion of road tennis, we are prepared to work in a coordinated way. And following on this exercise, I think you will see a greater level of interaction among all of the parties involved, which can only do the sport good.
Touched on. One of the things that we've done at the National Sports Council, if I could speak for the National Sports Council, which is a bit of a stretch, is that at the insistence of the minister, the Sports Council has created a road tennis secretariat within the National Sports Council, headed by the Deputy Director, Neil Murrell, and he also has a small team who are focused 100% of the time on the development of road tennis. In fact, they were critical in the development of this entire process here. And I just want to remind persons or to alert persons that, in fact, that unit's job is going to continue long after the completion of this tournament. So I think that signals the national focus that the minister himself has set within the main sporting organization, which is the National Sports Council. So I know that that is something that we in the road tennis community have been asking for some time. I also know that at his insistence, at our recommendation, at his insistence, he has looked to increase the number of coaches available in road tennis. At the moment, I think there's one, and as far as I know, the minister has agreed that that number should increase to three. And I'll give you a little anecdote on that one. When we toured Jamaica, and we met with the Jamaica Sporting Authorities, their National Sports Council is actually divided into three. And at the end of the program, the head of the what is now Road Tennis Jamaica, his first thing was that he wanted to have four national coaches, national road tennis coaches in Jamaica by the end of 2016. I know they have one now, and they're actually putting on a program to have the additional three formed before the end of the year. So I'm just, when I was discussing it with the minister, I used that as an example of increased rate of development of the sport. So they're going to have four national coaches in road tennis just now. Also, I do want to speak to getting results out of the tournament. We have a secretariat, Sharon and Patrina, who have been working assiduously with us in compiling all the documentation and so on. And it's in our intention that they will release to the media the results of the tournament every day. So we are going to alleviate you of the problem of trying to come to us to get the results. We do expect you there to film some of it, but our secretariat will send to each media host the result of every match the following day. So I think that's important that you know that there's going to be somebody who's going to be communicating to you every day on the results of the previous night's matches. Okay. Good question, because I always believe that I've always felt that the responsibility to, if a sport wants to be known out there, the responsibility is on the sport to carry its results to the press. Too often sports lay back and wait for the media to come to them. Our job is to get our results to you. Okay, there are two quick things I want to touch on before we finish up. One is we will be doing a demonstration of what we call adaptive road tennis. And that is, if we want road tennis to be a game that we package to be palatable internationally, then we must have road tennis for all. It must be an inclusive sport. And towards that end, we've met over the last month or so, 2 months, we've been meeting with the local schools for special needs. And we're hoping to put on a local tournament in conjunction with the Barbados Road Tennis Association, because the function of the World Road Tennis Federation is not necessary to hold tournaments on the local level. We will be holding an international world tournament once every 4 years. Initially, it will be in Barbados. It will move around. But whenever we work, we would tend to work through the local organization. So I've already had preliminary meetings with the executive of the Barbados World Tennis Association towards putting on a tournament for special needs next year. And as a precursor to that, we're going to use the World Championships to showcase world tennis for special needs. And in fact, I was really excited when I discussed it with the guys coming from the USA, and they're going to be bringing two special needs world tennis players, one of which is a double amputee. And so we're going to have some demos. I know Philip and his team are working. They've received special training from the special needs schools so that they can coach, they can really bring their coaching skills to bear for special needs people, and they will in fact be showcasing road tennis for special needs as part of the program for the international championships. So till COB, you that will be another first. It will be the first time that we are really focusing on road tennis for special needs. Okay, yeah, wonderful. I've been prompted to remember sports.bb, Steve Williams. We want to thank you guys for working with us in carrying this World Tennis Championship. We are streaming it, and we are streaming it to all of those social media that you guys are so fond of getting involved with, and I'm so frustrated with my kids that spending all their time watching. But for once, it's going to be very good. So I want to thank Stephen and his company, sports.bb, for being an associate sponsor, because this is an expensive process to do that. Stephen has kindly sponsored us much of his time and his resources in getting it done. So I'm really excited by it, because not only is it going to allow us to stream the games live out over the web, but also he's going to be using that feed at the actual championships to show some exciting things on our monitor. So we're really, really looking forward to that, you know. So because nowadays when I go to a game, for some reason when I'm watching the game live, I'm also looking at the TV camera for action replay. I think this is going to be the first that sort of thing is going to be available in road tennis. We've got the winning trophy, and I wonder why in my road tennis playing days, which seemed like years and years ago, trophies like this weren't available, Philip. Yeah? My cabinet, they're all, you can't hardly see them.
Probably didn't measure much.
You're probably right. This is the trophy that the winning men and the winning ladies will get. It's quite an impressive trophy. And we want to thank Trophy World also for being an associate sponsor. In providing much of the trophies at very good rates for us. And we're really proud of this trophy. It really is very nice. It makes me want to dust it off. No, $20,000 is a good thing, too. And if Antoine Daniel could do it, maybe I can do it, too. And finally, we want to show you guys the gear that's going to be available. And we're working with WOW Displays to provide this. All of the players will have that gear there. We're excited by it, and I hope the COB people are happy. And I'm trying to look and see if I can see the World Road Tennis Federation there, but all I'm seeing is COB.
And I'm not seeing NSC.
It is there. It's there. All right. So obviously, Vince, you did a wonderful job in getting COB everywhere there. Congratulations. Okay, I guess that is about it. Hopefully we've introduced you to the main sponsor or title sponsor, COB. We want to thank them again for getting on board. We've talked about our associate sponsors, Turbo Energy Drink, Cool Runnings, Crown Water, Fruit of Juices, Sports.bb. We've updated you to the number of countries that are coming in. I believe there are 24 persons in all. We've told you about where they're staying and so on. Philip has given you an update on the preliminaries, and we've had a chance to see all the fancy trophies and the prizes. Thanks, everybody, for coming. It's been a pleasure having you.